I come bearing good news. Today's sponsor, Fast Hosts, have gone all out and are offering one lucky person a dream PC setup worth up to $5,000. There's a question you need to answer, so stay tuned and I'll ask it later. Imagine it's 1992, and rather than installing a fresh copy of Microsoft DOS on your computer like a good little person, you instead opted for a rival operating system. All seemed dandy until you went to install Windows 3.1, and then you received this horrific error message. Hello there, I'm Nostalgia Nerd, and today we're looking at the ARD code. If you watched my last video, you may get some deja vu because we're back on the subject of digital research DOS. What a time to be alive. Digital research, once the industry leader in operating systems, had by 1990 been on the back foot for about 10 years. Ever since Microsoft gazumped them by licensing 86 DOS and making a deal with IBM to have it the cheapest choice with their IBM personal computer. They had been trying to claw back steadily, but without too much success. You might think then that Microsoft would no longer see them as a threat. Wrong. DR-DOS were still small fry, but from 1990 to 91, their sales revenue doubled from $15 million to $30 million, and by the first quarter of 1992, they were set to double that yet again. The main driver for these sales were tech-savvy PC vendors and computer magazine journalists switching to what they deemed a more favourable experience. To overcome Microsoft, Digital Research had been doing the only thing they could – make a better product. DR-DOS 5, released in May 1990, was just that. It was the first DOS which allowed you to load drivers into both high and extended memory, saving vital conventional RAM. It also had a more pleasant command set and generally better utilities. Its success meant that Novell would purchase Digital Research with an agreement on the 17th of July 1991 worth $80 million. Their plan was to heavily gear DR-DOS up for networking, posing an even more serious problem for Microsoft. DR-DOS 6, released in September 91, built upon these foundations. It included the TaskMax switching API for a pseudo-multitasking environment, a Visual Directory Manager, and even superstores on the fly disk compression, something Microsoft hadn't even considered at this point. All these factors meant that Microsoft were feeling some serious strain. Their initial response was to try and purchase Novell, but to no avail. In fact, Novell instead made agreements with IBM to ship and promote DR-DOS with their systems, rather than Microsoft DOS. Microsoft's follow-up was therefore to mount a somewhat more sinister plan based around Windows. After all, Windows was the future, their future. And so, in the run-up to releasing Windows 3.1, various meetings were set up and emails exchanged. On the exact day that Novell purchased Digital Research, Jim Allchin, who was then in charge of Microsoft's unreleased Cairo operating system, sent out an email voicing concerns with Novell and IBM's partnership. The email mentioned speaking to Novell about their plans and getting serious with their in-house networking efforts, including getting Wimble, which was codenamed for Windows with Workgroups, into Windows 3.1 as soon as possible. But it's point G which is of most interest. We consider changing our apps to not run unless the OS is our OS. This clearly sparked the imagination of many employees within Microsoft. Some were less than happy, but some were fully behind it. Shortly after, Brad Silverberg would send an email back to Jim concurring his concerns with DR-DOS. After IBM announces support for DR-DOS at COMDEX, my best hunch is that they will offer DR-DOS as the preferred solution. DR-DOS has problems running Windows today, and I assume will have more problems in the future. But the thing is, DR-DOS didn't really have any issues running Windows at all. That last statement seemed to be making a cloaked point more than anything else. Jim Alchin would respond, "You should make sure it has problems in the future." Smiley face. As the autumn weather swept in, more members of Microsoft became convinced of this direction, and an email was sent from Microsoft's head of development, David Cole. "We should surely crash the system. The approach we will take is to detect DR-DOS 6 and refuse to load. The error message should be something like, invalid device driver interface. Maybe there are several very sophisticated checks, so competitors get put on a treadmill. Aaron R. has some pretty wild ideas, after three or so beers. Earl H. has some too. The less people know about exactly what gets done, the better." This seemed to suggest that if a user happened to be running DR-DOS, an error message should appear to stop the software from operating. Over the next 2 months, somewhat thanks to those in disagreement in Microsoft, the plan changed to make the error simply a visual one, a fabrication that did nothing more than appear and then disappear. Microsoft's vice president sent out an email advising the assigned developers that the code detecting DR-DOS better be perfect, otherwise you could be in a heap of trouble. The aforementioned Aaron Reynolds set to work implementing it, and as requested, it was cleverly hidden and thoroughly encrypted. This DR-DOS bomb was included in the Christmas beta version of Windows 3.1. Here then was a GUI designed to completely elevate itself from what had gone before. TrueType fonts were added, 386 enhanced mode was added, up to 4GB of memory could be utilized, file manager was overhauled, icons could be dragged and dropped for the first time, and importantly, stability was far superior to that of Windows 3. Of course, that is unless you were running DR-DOS, just like those PC vendors, journalists, and prominent PC advisors who thought that DR-DOS was the way forward, until they loaded their beta copies of Windows 3.1 and received an error message that Microsoft DOS users just weren't getting. Did DR-DOS have some serious problems running Windows? Of course it didn't. DR-DOS was perfectly compatible with Windows 3.1, and the stability was as good under DR-DOS as it was under MS-DOS. The message would appear and then vanish, but the misinformation spread through the tech industry regardless. As you might expect, Digital Research and Novell were completely denied access to beta copies of Windows 3.1, but were simply able to circumnavigate the issue by working with DR-DOS users who were Windows 3.1 beta testers. Through these means, they quickly rolled out what they called a Windows 3.1 compatible business update, which bypassed the issue and prevented the error from displaying. But this wasn't the days of on-demand internet access, and updates weren't simply pushed out on the fly. Users could download the update from the DR forum on CompuServe if they had access and indeed wanted to, but the damage was done. All this rollout seemingly achieved was to compound the fact that it was a Digital Research problem, not a Microsoft one. In February 1992, Senior Vice President Brad Silverberg sent out an email to the highest ranks of Microsoft confirming the strategy. "What the guy is supposed to do is feel uncomfortable, and when he has bugs, suspects the problem is DR-DOS and then go out to buy MS-DOS or decide not to take the risk for the other machines he has to buy in the office." And indeed it was working. By the fourth quarter of 1992, many manufacturers had erred on the side of caution and decided to bundle MS-DOS. Sales of DR-DOS had dropped from $15 million to only $1.4 million. Users were switching back to Microsoft, or simply waiting for the newly announced MS-DOS 6 due in the first quarter of 1993, disk compression included. Now, of course, some people got wise to this situation pretty quick, and in fact, by April 1992, people outside of Microsoft were starting to document the code and its workings. Jeff Chappell was one of those people, and if you visit his website, jeffchappell.com, he documents the discovery process in some detail. In April 1992, Jeff was emailing back and forth with Andrew Shulman regarding some new updates included with Windows 3.1, namely the HiMem.sys driver, which replaces the current DOS version on installation and allows programs to store data in extended memory, a feature which DRDOS 5 had, if you remember. This information was for their respective books, On Documented Windows by Andrew and DOS Internals by Jeff. On the cold morning of the 17th of April, Jeff fired off an email regarding a large amount of really stupid code, lots wasted, some encrypted with XOR, in HiMem 3.03. By the evening, he had written a procedure to activate this obfuscated code. Following this, on the 8th of June 92, Jeff would publish a message on the CIX conferencing system, this time regarding the Windows 3.1 executable itself, win.com. It details how the code checks for readings on various input devices, and that if they all return values that agree with a standard MS-DOS install, then no error is activated. However, some non-Microsoft versions of DOS, including DR, would return different values, thereby activating the error. Jeff writes how the code is littered with red herrings, long and convoluted operations whose results are discarded, and how there is XOR encryption in place, seemingly designed entirely to obscure this part of the code, the only non-encrypted part being the word ARD. ARD being the signature Microsoft developer Aaron Reynolds used to sign off his code. It's a bit like a serial killer leaving his name in blood at the crime scene. Jeff also notes that the win.com he was inspecting would execute but not actually act upon the code, and that's because the code in the actual retail version that he had was deactivated. Of course, by the time they went to retail, Microsoft was satisfied with the damage they'd already done with the beta version, and so tried to cover their tracks and forget about the whole thing. But significantly, by leaving the code in, if Microsoft felt threatened, it could be reactivated at any time by any update they wished to distribute. Writing in the Dr. Dobbs journal, Andrew Shulman would expand on this investigation and Jeff's work and define a crucial part of the ARD test, which first checks whether a network redirector is running, and if so, then checks the DOS default uppercase map is located in the DOS data segment. If it's not running, it checks that the pointer to the first simulated file control block has a zero offset. The crucial part here is that all versions of MS-DOS pass this test every time, whereas no version of DR-DOS does, simply due to the way it's written. This code was built into other executables, such as the Windows Setup Program, the Disk Caching Utility, Smart Drive, and even MSD, Microsoft Diagnostics, all packaged with Windows Beta Build 6.1 and the pre-release build 3.1.068, rolled out in January 1992. All the errors are pretty similar and vague, but with different error numbers.
This isn't how to run a business, come on! You need to secure what's important. Customers, brand, assets.
Whether you're doing video production or cat grooming, every business needs a name, a domain. Get your brand, it's important to secure it. Fast Hosts makes it incredibly easy to find and register your brand name with their domain names. Then back up your data, don't keep all your videos on one crappy drive. Use Fast Hosts Cloud Backup and get 5GB absolutely free. Now, about that question I mentioned earlier.
According to perhaps urban legend, how much memory did Bill Gates claim ought to be enough for anybody? Answer that and you could win your dream PC. Come to think of it, I need a new editing PC.
Enter at fasthosts.co.uk for all the details. The link is below. So Microsoft had done it. They had won the battle using perhaps sneaky and weaselly tactics, but maybe they hadn't quite won the war. In 1995, several former employees of Novell set up Caldera Incorporated. The objective of this company was to create network utilities with a focus on the Linux operating system. But with a desire to have a DOS operating system bundled with their open Linux distribution, they would acquire Novell DOS and Digital Research on the 23rd of July 1996. This deal consisted of a direct payment of $400,000, as well as a percentage of DR-DOS royalties. But on the same day of acquisition, having acquired the rights, Caldera would launch an antitrust lawsuit against Microsoft. This was not just in relation to their ARD code, but also that Microsoft had combined MS-DOS 7 with Windows 4, which ultimately was Windows 95, to prevent DR-DOS substituting for MS-DOS. Caldera argued that to create this illusion, Microsoft simply hid MS-DOS 7 behind the screen of blue sky and white clouds displayed during the now familiar Windows 95 startup process, and went even further to demonstrate that DR-DOS could be substituted for MS-DOS using a tool they developed called WinGlue. Even though Microsoft claimed that Windows 95 was its own standalone operating system, Caldera exposed the plethora of calls that were going on behind the scenes between DOS 7 and what was effectively Windows 4. And I mean, really, anyone who used Windows 95 should be aware of how important DOS still was in the process, and how much Windows 95 actually got in the way of running anything particularly resource intensive. Of course, Microsoft would dispute all of this, but it was perhaps Microsoft's own internal communication that was most damning. In fact, as far back as 1992, Microsoft were talking about completely eliminating their rival DOS problem. In June 1992, Brad Silverberg had distributed the Chicago Strategy document. Novell is after the desktop. This is perhaps our biggest threat. We must respond in a strong way by making Chicago a complete Windows operating system from boot up to shutdown. There will be no place or need on a Chicago machine for DR-DOS, or any DOS. Chicago, of course, being the codename for Windows 95. It was those same internal communications which bolstered Caldera's claims around the ARD code and their claims of Microsoft's illegal tying, monopolization, exclusive dealing, and tortious interference. The original case had been built on Jeff and Andrew's analysis of the camouflage code, but it was these emails exposed through a court request which really put the nails in Microsoft's coffin. The case rattled on until the 7th of January 2000, with a trial penned in for the 1st of February. However, with Microsoft also involved in other antitrust legal cases, such as Netscape, they decided to settle with Caldera, costing some $280 million. Brian Sparks, CEO of Caldera, commented, "We are pleased with the result of this lawsuit. We now look forward to vigorous competition in the marketplace with our Linux products and strategies, both from Caldera Systems Inc. and Linio Inc." Shortly after, Caldera would spin out into various other companies, but would ultimately fizzle out. The DR-DOS assets fell to the Canopy Group and were acquired by Device Logix, who shortly after incorporated as DR-DOS Inc. But like so many cases involving Microsoft, the giant would rattle on, and the subsequent companies around it would vanish. It's a sad end, really, but hey, many of us are still here using Windows 10, and that's just the way the cookie crumbles. As for me, well, I'm about to install DR-DOS on some old computers. Looks like I've got some catching up to do. Thanks for watching. Have a great evening.